And we have a special speaker this morning, Kendra Pierre-Louis, who is going to talk about looking at climate change through the lens of solutions. Kendra is a senior climate reporter with the Gimlet Spotify podcast, How to Save a Planet. Before that, she was a climate reporter with the New York Times and a staff writer for Popular Science, where she wrote about science topics, the environment, and mayonnaise. Okay. She's author of the book Greenwashed, Why We Can't Buy Our Way to a Green Planet. Kendra is a graduate of, has a master's degree in science writing from MIT and in sustainable development with a focus on policy analysis and advocacy from the SIT Graduate Institute. So looking forward to hearing Kendra. Kendra, welcome to our platform.
I just want to say thanks so much for having me. If I seem super awkward, this is because this is my first in-person presentation in 2.5 years. So apologies in advance, because I will probably be very awkward. So the conversation today is looking at climate through the lens of solution. And in order to do that, a little bit about me, sort of, next slide. I would prefer not to. I'm not. So a little bit about me. As Richard previously said, I'm a climate reporter for the Gimlet Spotify podcast, How to Save a Planet. And this photo that you see of me is about 7 years ago, where I'm doing the very climate reportery thing of drinking from a glacier, from the Greenland ice sheet. And these days, next slide, this is where I work. Part of me drink. So in theory, this would play music, but we have some technical issues. So I work for a podcast. And the beauty of the podcast is that we focus on climate change exclusively through solutions. That's the only thing that we look at. And to understand what it means to look at climate through solutions, it helps to understand where we are at in this present moment. Next slide, please. Click again. Yeah, okay. So the slide that you're looking at is a really good place to start. And what the chart is saying, frankly, is if you were born like I was after 1976, you have never experienced a normal temperature year. You have never known an unusually cool temperature year. Climate change isn't coming, it's here. And this fact will frame everything that follows. Next slide, please. So one of the things that we talk about a lot in the climate space is that climate change, the thing that I most want to impart on people when I talk about climate change is that climate change touches everything, all the creatures, great and small. So in this case, what you're looking at is what's known as a ghost moose. It happens in New England, and what happens in New England is that the snows are coming later and later, so which gives ticks a chance to stick around longer. And they, when the ticks stick around, they attack the moose, and they essentially drain the moose of blood, and the moose die. The moose look like this because they're spending a lot of their time and a lot of their energy scraping their bodies against trees and other structures to try to get the ticks off. So moose are great. And next slide. And small. So this is the Barmbo K. Mullamese. If I'm honest, I kind of think it's ugly. I'm not a fan of rodents. I had a traumatic mice incident when I was 4. and so if I'm putting this rodent on screen, which I'm openly saying that I hate, there's got to be a big reason. And the reason is that this poor fella is the first creature known to become extinct because of climate change. So it's affecting everything at all scales. Next slide. So this is from the summer of 2017. This is a satellite image of Greenland on fire. The country burned for almost a month after an unusually warm, dry, and sunny weather that researchers linked to climate change. The fires burned severely enough on peatlands that they became vulnerable to permafrost thawing, which also releases many of the gases, which when the permafrost thaws, it releases methane, which contributes to climate change. Next slide. We know because of climate change, we're experiencing longer, more catastrophic fires. Fires are part of many ecosystems, but what we're seeing with climate change is not sort of the normal traditional fires that ecosystems have adapted to. The fire season is longer, not just in the West, but also in the East. The fires are bigger and more catastrophic. This particular fire is from the 2018 Woolsey Fire, which killed three people, burned more than 1,500 buildings, and caused more than $6 billion of damage. Next slide, please. These are from this year's Pakistani floods, which flooded over a third of the country. If you want to think about in surface areas, it's as if New England almost flooded. Next slide, please. This is the Townsville, Australia flooding, I believe from 2017. Next slide, please. This is a picture from the current Ethiopian drought. Next slide, please. And so I want to loop back to that chart again, that one that I said in the beginning. This chart is mostly looking at, it's looking at global sea surface temperatures. I want you to look at another chart, which is similar but different. Next chart, please. This is average global sea surface temperature. So this is global sea surface, this is the temperatures in the ocean. And just like air temperatures are getting warmer, ocean temperatures are getting warmer, and it's as bad for us as it was in that previous chart. Next slide, please. So this is a chart of mass coral reef bleaching in Australia's Great Barrier Reef. This is the first picture is the healthier reef in December 2014. The next one is of it dying or bleaching in February 2015, and this is it dead in August 2015. I talked to someone, the thing you have to bear in mind is prior to human-induced warming of the Earth's climate, bleaching was only a very localized and short-term event. Sean Connolly, an associate professor at Australia's James Cook University, told me back in 2017. You might get a bit of localized bleaching in a lagoon if there was an extreme low tide and the water was sitting there for a long time and it was hot and the sun was shining, but you wouldn't get this kind of widespread bleaching. And the thing is that I really want to drill in is when we look at coral reefs as people who live in New York City, we may look at it as an aesthetic issue. It's ugly, it's sad. But as the reefs die, the fish that depend on them die too. It's useful to think of coral reefs not as, as oases in the desert. Those sort of tropical regions where coral reefs appear are in many ways biologically dead. There isn't as much nutrient because warm water doesn't hold as much nutrient, much food as cooler water. And so as these coral reefs bleach, the fish disappear. And as the fish disappear, my computer has decided to die on me. I'm not gonna worry about it. As the fish disappear, what ends up happening is the people that depend on the fish need to move. They don't have food anymore. And so one researcher that I talked to at the University of British Columbia said, point blank, this is why we get forced migration. It's because people just don't have the food that they're dependent on. Next slide, please, while I try and figure out. This is Tropical Storm Fiona, which just hit Puerto Rico last week. Next slide, please. This is what it looked like in Fiona in Puerto Rico. Next slide, please. And this is what happened just yesterday when Fiona hit the Atlantic coast of Nova Scotia. Next slide, please. This closer to home, this is a remnants of Tropical Storm Ida when it hit New York City last summer. Next slide, please. This is Hurricane Harvey in 2017. Hurricane Harvey got a ton of attention because it was a Category 4 when it made landfall. But really the reason Hurricane Harvey was so catastrophic was because it was a slow moving storm. It just sat over the Gulf Coast for days. It dropped so much rain that it took weeks for all of that water to go away. And that's another hallmark of climate change. Next slide, please. We are, I really wish I could read my notes. We are getting more and more billion-dollar disaster years, and almost the vast majority of years where there have been more than 10 individual disaster events that have cost $1 billion, almost all of them, almost all but like two have happened since the year 2000. Next slide, please. So now that I've laid all of this out on you, how are you feeling? Do you feel motivated to do something about it? Or do you feel like you want to crawl into bed and maybe never come out? So, okay, how many want to do something? And how many kind of want to take a nap? So I think you guys are a biased crew because I feel like for most people, the nappers win. They kind of feel like I'm learning about all of these horrible things and it feels so big and it feels so out of my control and I'm being inundated with all of this bad stuff. There was a reason that I was doing that to you today. Next slide, please. This is how I feel most of the time when I'm not thinking about climate solutions. And so I don't think this is a useful place to be emotionally if you actually expect people to do something about climate change. It's a stuck place to be. It's a panicked place to be. How clearly are you thinking when you're panicked? Not very, right? Next slide, please. Hit it again. And I feel like when you read the newspaper, you're going to click it a bunch of times, sorry. When you're reading the newspaper, what you're getting are headlines like this: mega drought in the American South. Last a climate disaster unseen in 1,200 years. Next, click again. UN chief calls Pakistan floods a climate catastrophe. Click again. One more time. Oh yeah, a summer of climate disasters. Climate change has made extreme weather increasingly normal. Are any of these motivating to you? Click again.
20. Not to touch it.
Yeah. Audio professional over here. Thank you. Sorry, I'm just gonna use backup notes on my phone. Sorry, 1 second. But that what we're seeing up here is sort of the dominant narrative that we often are faced when we think about climate change, when we see it in the news at all, because often we don't see it in the news. And so the next question that I have for you guys is, do you feel alone in thinking about climate? Like, do you feel sort of like you're the only one? If you do, raise your hand. It's okay. How isolated do you feel in thinking about climate change? Like, do you feel like, sorry? Okay, outside of this community. So the people that you don't, if you're thinking about your larger sort of non-ethical society community in the larger world, do you feel like the weirdo that thinks about climate, or do you think that like lots of people think about climate? So how many of you think a lot of people think about climate? How many of you think not that many? So next slide, please. This is something that Yale Climate Communication does called the Six Americas. It's a sort of breakdown of the ways in which they think about people's American attitudes towards climate. And it goes from alarmed all the way to dismissive. And dismissive is what you would consider a climate denialist. And then alarmed is kind of like somebody who's super active and engaged on climate. Where do you think most people fall? Disengaged. Okay, interesting. Next slide. Most people are actually alarmed or concerned, so you're not alone, but you feel alone, and you feel alone in part because of how we talk about climate. We don't talk about climate in ways that helps you find the other people that are similarly concerned and can actually do something about it. Next slide. So on the few times when sort of climate solutions are put into the public sphere, it kind of ends up falling into two buckets. And the first bucket is the individual bucket. Click, please. One more time. Yeah. It tells you to put solar panels on a roof. It tells you to fly less. It tells you to recycle. And it tells you to use reusable tote bags. Considering what I just laid out as a scale of the problem that we're facing, do any of these solutions feel adequate? I'm considering the scale of the problems that I just laid out. Do any of these solutions feel adequate? Does it kind of feel like trying to bail out the Titanic with a teaspoon? Does this make you want to do things?
I'm doing them.
Yeah, exactly. You're doing them, but you're like, in a nihilistic way, right? You're doing it because it feels like you, almost like you have to. So on the other side, click please, when they do tell us about solutions, they feel so big and out of our hands. And so it's things like invest in renewables, or decarbonize the grid, or, you know, fix mass transit. How many of us want to fix the subways? How many of us can fix the subways? If you work for the MTA, give me a call, because I have some. Exactly. So what's missing is the connection between those two, between how we as individuals can help push the levers on those big things that sort of feel out of reach. Next slide, please. So what is a climate solution? And I'm talking now about how we as a show approach climate solutions, and we think of them as something that will either reduce greenhouse gas emissions or help us better adapt to sort of what's already cooking, right? Next slide, please. So how do we look at solutions? The things we need to change are one side, and then the levers of power that we need to create change, right? So we need to invest in renewable energy as a society, right? But that also means we need to stop investing in oil and gas, right? How do we do that? Right, so those are the questions. Those are the big questions that we look at as a show, and those are the ones that we break down for our listeners. Next slide, please. And I don't know if this will play, but we'll find out. If you just hit the like, the one before, the little, if you click the music tab. Nope. Let's see, I really want to play, so I'm going to try and see if I can play it from my phone. Up on the mic, I mean.
So the students started formulating their statements to present at the supervisors' meeting. They wrote pretty
typical. I was so excited to figure out if whether or not I could get this clip to play. I forgot to set it up. Again, audio professional over here. I warned you this would be awkward. So we recently did an episode. So this was kind of our ethos as a show, is we wanted to kind of bridge that gap. We wanted to look at the things that were real big solutions and then look at ways as you, as people, as listeners, as individuals, could get together with other people and look at levers of change that they could use to kind of make these big systemic things happen. And this year, this September, this was our second year of our show, we did a birthday episode. So we sent out a request to listeners to ask them, you know, it's been 2 years that you've been listening to How to Save a Planet. What have you done in those 2 years? Because every episode ends with a call to action. And we got a bunch of listener emails and people did all sorts of stuff. We had people introduce legislation. We had people run for public office. And one of the ones that people did was there was this community off the coast of Santa Barbara where Exxon had had an oil spill in 2015. And after Exxon had had the oil spill, they weren't able to get oil from this oil rig to the refinery because the pipeline had burst and they had not yet been able to rebuild this pipeline. So the oil hadn't been moving. And Exxon had come up with a plan where there was like a temporary pipeline that would get it to the coast. They would fill up a bunch of trucks and they would take the trucks to ship it through this community and ship it to the refinery. And so there were students in this community that were like, no, we don't want this to happen. And, you know, they did, and this is the setup, and this is what happened. Sorry, it's kind of long.
So the students started formulating their statements to present at the supervisors' meeting. They wrote pretty typical environmental arguments, like how the project would impact habitat and water resources along the highway, Exxon's contributions to climate change, that sort of thing.
Which sounds like it was winding up to be, you know, a pretty typical jobs versus environment fight. The students were saying, think about the environment. The pro-Exxon folks, I'm assuming, were saying that if we truck this oil, it'll bring jobs and economic benefits.
It could have shaped up to be an argument like that, but the students decided to include another argument, one they learned from our episode, The Shareholders vs. Exxon. In that episode, Larry Fink, the CEO of BlackRock, the largest asset management firm in the world, said, climate change is bad for the business of companies like Exxon. Here's Fink.
You know, I'm doing this not as an environmentalist. I'm doing this as a capitalist who truly believes that climate change is investment risk. Many companies are ill-prepared for this.
So the EAB decided to do something you don't usually see student activists do, which is lean into the argument of a billionaire CEO and use that as part of their statements at the Board of Supervisors meeting.
Good morning. Welcome. I'll call to order the March 8, 2022 meeting of the Santa Barbara County Board of Supervisors here in the Santa
After months of outreach to local officials, including speaking before the County Planning Commission, which recommended denying Exxon for safety reasons, the EAB logged into the Zoom for the Board of Supervisors meeting where a final decision was going to be made. When the EAB students got their turn on the mic, they presented their arguments against the Exxon plan, citing climate change, damage to the local ecosystem, and quoting from BlackRock CEO Larry Fink.
In 2021, BlackRock, the world's largest asset management firm, stated the following. Exxon must further assess its strategy. The company's current reluctance to do so has the potential to undermine its long-term financial sustainability. If even the world's largest asset manager doubts Exxon viability, then why should we trust it with our jobs? Supervisors, Exxon will not create and sustain the jobs it claims. I urge you to deny the Exxon trucking proposal. Thank you.
After more public comment from members of the community, from Exxon corporate, from tons of environmental activist groups, it was time for the supervisors to make their statements and vote. And as they voted, one of the supervisors directly referenced what the EAB said about BlackRock in his comment.
One of the world's largest financial asset managers, BlackRock, stated last year that ExxonMobil should further assess its strategy and board expertise against the possibility that demand for fossil fuels may decline rapidly in the coming decades. I will be voting to deny this application because I cannot make the finding.
The Board of Supervisors as a whole voted 3-2 to deny Exxon's proposal, meaning Exxon won't be trucking their oil through these areas and they won't be able to drill oil at these platforms for the foreseeable future. When the students reached out to thank the supervisors afterwards, they got a response from the supervisor who they weren't sure would end up voting in their direction. The supervisor said, quote, EAB letter and testimony showed that the claimed benefits were much more speculative than claimed. We just followed your evidence, end quote. Jesse, another one of the students that we talked to, believes that being able to make that economic argument was really important in getting those votes.
They kind of like cheated us more naively and like children, like, oh, save the salamanders, you know, oh, we need to save these foxes. So at that moment, I think is when it became less of them looking at us as naive students and realized that, oh, they've actually connected the dots and they realize that there's a different argument that they need to make.
So they won. They. Which I gotta say as a show felt great, you know, because you stick things out in the world and you're not sure, but it sort of validated our central thesis, which is that people wanna act, people wanna do things about climate change. They just don't have the information and a lot of news is not giving them the information to act on it in ways. So Jesse didn't do it alone, that it was a team of students that got together and they reached out to a teacher, an advisor to help them, right? So often when we talk about solutions, we talk about solutions in the guise of this one individual who will bring about social change. That's just not how change works. We need people to work together. And so that's kind of, as a reporter, pivoting from focusing just on problems to focusing more on solution, that's an ethos that we have as a show. I mean, even to put this episode together, you don't make a podcast on your own. You know, I might be the lead reporter or the lead producer on an episode, but I have an editor, it goes through team edits. We have an engineer who makes it sound good, who does the scoring. Like every episode is touched by 8 to 10 hands. It's a collective effort. And so as a show, that's kind of our ethos. What are the solutions that we can get people on board with to get other people on board with, like kind of a snowball? So that's one. And then the other that we joke about is go to the meetings that nobody ever thinks about, go to the meetings people haven't heard about. One of the guys who wrote into us, he ran for his utility board commission and is, as far as he knows, the only person who's ever run for it. It's generally one of those positions that people just sort of slide into because they're sort of in the political sphere in his community. So there are things like that that people did. And then on the other side, all those titles that I showed you, how often do you want to read a climate change article? You're like bracing yourself for bad news, right? But as a podcast, because we're focusing on solutions, there's lots of things. One, as a listener, you know that no matter how low we're bringing you, we're going to end on a place where you feel like there's something you can do that's something empowering. And maybe it's not the solution for you. Maybe it's not that it doesn't fit into like where you are in the world or what you can do individually, but you know that somebody can act on it. So there's that element of it. And then as a reporter, it also means that I have space to be playful. I can be fun. We can make, I don't know if that wasn't the best clip for it, but we make a lot of jokes. We're a fun show to listen to, and that's why I think people get on board. But I think more importantly, we're not just trying to get people to listen, we're trying to get people to act. And I think that's why people do things. The other thing as a reporter is it frees me up to think differently, because when you're focusing so much on problems, it narrows your field of vision. So for an example, how many of you know that riding a bicycle is a climate solution? Riding a bicycle is a climate solution, right? Does it not feel like we talk about riding a bicycle the way we talk about eating your vegetables? It is the thing that you know you ought to be doing, but French fries are so delicious, right? So recently I was on my bike, like several months ago, and I was realizing that I don't ride a bike because it's a climate solution. I ride a bike because it's fun. I've always ridden a bike because it's fun. I hate driving. I drive, but I drive out of obligation. I ride out of necessity and fun. It can get me to where I want to go, but mostly I ride because it's fun. And so I wanted to do an episode that you would know it would be very difficult to do as a print publication, as a non-solutions publication. And the episode was basically, riding a bike is fun. That was the thesis of my episode, 30 minutes on how riding a bike was fun. And part of why I wanted to do that is because I realized, I was rewatching Clueless, don't judge, and it dawned on me how much of that movie is based in car culture and how much it makes cars look sexy. And how so many movies are based in car culture and make cars look sexy. And how so much of the way we consume culture makes bicycle riding look dorky or slow or for children. And so the goal of the episode was kind of twofold. One, to kind of counteract that message. And to do that, I go into the history about how, like, at one point in history, bicycle was seen as the next greatest thing to flying. It was considered advanced technology. I do all of that. I do all of the journalism things that you're supposed to do. But I also just sort of reiterate, I went to class where adults were learning how to ride a bike for the first time. I treated bicycles as a serious object in a form of poetry almost. And as part of that, and this is where the fun and the whimsy of why solutions I think is so important comes in, and I swear this one's not 4 minutes long, is I got to, we made a jingle. And this is where I'm gonna end it and where we can open it up to some conversation, I think. This is, again, it takes a village to make a podcast. Our engineer made a jingle. You do not want me to sing and you do not want me to make music. So, and if the one thing that I promise after this talk is that in a week, you will be humming this jingle to yourself and you will be cursing my name and I will be proud of that.
Fun to move, powered by you, and not through fossil fuels. Ride down some stairs, park anywhere. That's the beauty of biking. Fun, clean, healthy. That's the beauty of cycling. Accessible physical mountains and roads. That's the beauty of biking. It's fun, clean, healthy. That's the beauty of cycling. Accessible physical mountains and roads. That's the beauty of biking. It's fun to move. Fossil fuels, ride down some stairs, park anywhere. That's the beauty of biking.
So questions? Anyone have any questions?
Please wait for the microphone.
Predictable. Thanks very much for extolling the virtues and the fun of cycling. I'm an avid, maybe fanatical cyclist myself since coming to New York in 1993, as I recall. It really is fun. You've got to watch yourself out there. It is a car-dominated landscape, right? But truly, it is fun. I had my own mountain bike stolen a couple of days ago. That's one thing you've got to be sure of. You got to secure the bike. It was an old bike. I thought, nobody wants this thing. It's not an e-bike. Why would anyone? Well, sure enough, what was left was my front wheel, which I had correctly locked to the rack. Anyway, thanks for that. E-bikes are another thing. I mean, I'm ambivalent about e-bikes. They're a lot friendlier than cars and SUVs.
Is there a question?
Yes, sorry. There is. Okay, let me. What do you think about e-bikes? You know, as something that is eco-friendly, fun if you want to. Just in general.
I think for a lot of. So I got COVID for the first time in July, and e-bikes were the first bikes that I was able to ride after I got COVID. So I mean, for a lot of people, that's how they can get over bridges. They're great. I mean, obviously. I mean, for me anyway, and the point of the story is that to create a recognition that biking is fun and it's this thing that's being stolen from you and it's actually a viable form of transportation so that we have more people pushing for better bike infrastructure so that you're not in a war with cars on the road. So that was kind of the goal and the point of the episode. It wasn't to get people to want to cycle and fight cars. The goal is like, no, we need to reduce the role of cars in our society. And one way we can do that and still have that independence of transportation is through cycling. And for me, that means making cycling itself more accessible. And I think e-bikes are a way of doing that. Trikes are a way of doing that. Cargo bikes are a way of doing that. And I think that moving forward, we need to think about many kinds of biking and the people who bike and, you know, the different abilities of people who bike.
Hi, thank you for all of that. I was particularly struck by the use of the investment firm's comments and the idea that, well, you know, people are still trying to make money, we're still in this capitalist system. Something that I see a lot is sort of resistance to the idea of investment, you know, building housing. Okay, well, that's obviously, you know, we don't want someone to be making money right now. This might be an expenditure, but in the future, this dense housing, you know, people will be able to live more sustainably. And I'm sort of in the like very online space where it feels hard to wrangle people who are really resistant to those steps and to the concessions to, okay, someone's going to make money on this. How have you found that, or has that not really been a problem once people really are taking action together?
So we consider ourselves like the sizzler of climate podcasts, which is like, we are a solutions-based podcast, that is our ethos, but it's a buffet. So you take and you pick and choose from that buffet what fits your values and your ethics and your ethos. And so for this group of students, they listened to our two-part episode on climate investing, and that was what they were able to pull from to make this change that they wanted in their community. And whether or not, like, I didn't talk to them, but their main producer did. And for them, it was very much a question of how do we talk to the people how do we talk to the decision makers in the language that they understand to bring about the change that we want? And for them, they understood that the language of salamanders and lizards and things and the harm that they were going to perpetuate by trucking these things in was not the language that would be successful, but that the language of BlackRock had a chance at being successful, and they were correct. So it's very much like, we don't tell anyone what to do. And I think that's kind of where we draw the line between, like, we're very much on the side of journalism, but what we try to do is give people the tools that they want, that they can choose from so that they can become activists. So like, that's like separate. So like, it's almost like, I joke and say that we're climate civics, but like so much of what we're doing is teaching people how to engage with their government and how to engage with their communities, because it seems like that aspect of media has been lost.
I have two comments, questions. The first one would be on heat pumps. Mm-hmm. I happen to have an apartment elsewhere that has heat pumps, and I find them to be wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
But convincing people here in the city about heat pumps is an entirely different issue. So that's number one. The second one's just very quick, and that is that I have a bicycle,
mm-hmm.
And I've installed training wheels. And the purpose of the training wheels is so you don't fall off when you either stop or start. And it's a wonderful, wonderful solution, because the riding of the bicycle is fun. The stopping and starting of a bicycle can be a disaster. So I think that that's a solution that you might consider for the future.
With the e-bike, with the heat pump comment, so I think in the city you have a bunch of issues. One is, you know, most people rent, they don't own, so they're like, I don't own, so I don't have control over my heat. The scale of the size of the buildings, there are more and more buildings that are moving towards or experimenting with heat pumps, and I think there's an all-electric building that just, like a fairly sizable one, that just put in heat pumps. But I think part of it is that it's just so much easier to put a heat pump into a single family home than it is to put it in a building, and I think that's some of the resistance. I know PTACs are a bigger thing in the city, which is at least moving towards all electric, which is kind of the goal, is to get away from fossil fuels for heating and cooling, and PTACs are at least all electric. Any other questions, comments? Is that jingle still in your head? I warned you. It's on Spotify if you're curious.
I'm wondering if anyone in the environmental movement has considered the possibility of bringing back train travel. It's so much cleaner than millions of cars on the road, and our rail system was dismantled to make way for the car. Is anybody working to bring it back? Because bicycles may be a nice solution for a few people, but I think public transportation is a better solution for masses of people.
So the big push is multimodal transportation. So it's not just bikes, it's rails, it's buses, electric buses, and yes, people are pushing for all of those solutions. There's been some push towards, I know California is in the process of putting in a high-speed rail. There are larger conversations that are kind of outside the scope about, like, it just takes a really long time to build capital projects in the United States, and there are smarter people than me that can dig into why. But yes, there are people pushing for those solutions as well. It's not just bikes. I think we have one more over there.
Are you familiar with the rapid bus transit system in Curitiba, Brazil? And if so, do you think that that is something that we will ever see here in the States?
I don't know about the one in Brazil, but there's one in Colombia that I think is pretty similar, and it's, so I love buses, and I'm doing kind of the way I did an episode on bikes, I'm doing an episode on buses, and it would be awesome if we had a system like that, because it's lower cost and it's more responsive. One of my kind of pet peeves in the United States is there just seems to be a very strong bias in a lot of places against buses. And so what ends up happening is cities make a guess on very costly light rail infrastructure, and they kind of guessed wrong. The light rail isn't going in the right place, or they don't have enough connections. The things that I really appreciate about buses is you can pilot things, and if you're wrong, they're pretty nimble. Like, you don't have to redo that much to kind of get those kinds of dedicated bus lines in and out. It's just, I think, to my point earlier, where there's like a lot of social stigma, and once you start watching it in the media against bikes, there's also a ton of social stigma in the media against buses. And so I think more than anything, it's not, the technology is nothing. It's the public will and the public understanding of what buses mean. And buses, unlike the subway, and are like just so much easier to make accessible for people in wheelchairs and people with different physical mobilities. And so I don't know if we'll ever see it, but like, I think I'm on board, if that's your point. Thank you.